Well, hello everybody, good evening, I'm Cosmic Claire and welcome to another one of my nightly evening video blogs here on the 8th of January 2013. Well, I'm kind of a bit late today because I've had a couple of setbacks and snags slowing me up. I had a cracking backache today for no apparent reason. Living with that and also technical problem with the computer, unfortunately, which has turned out not to be as serious as it could have been, but it will still need some attention. Anyway, I've still got online and it's before midnight, and all that didn't stop me getting out to go to a local community group meeting not far from here. And what the community group is about is about looking after and conserving a little wild woodland park just off the centre of Headingley. It's a wonderful little place. It's a triangular little piece of parkland which is never been used for building or anything like that. And it's just walled, and it's got actually original Victorian railings around it, which are something of a talking point, and they look very nice, incredibly, after all this time. And it turns out that this piece of land has unknown ownership, so there's all kind of negotiations going on to establish the status of it. Meanwhile, the community group is interested in keeping the place clean and tidy, managing the woodland in such a way as to encourage the most diverse ecological habitat, and going to give them a few wild species plants that I managed to cultivate from seed, and it's a very inspiring little place. Anybody who lives in Headingley will probably know it as the triangle on Cardigan Road. It's called Sparrow Park. It's a little bit of leftover after the botanical and zoological gardens of the 19th century closed down and was built upon with all those big houses down Cardigan Road. And it's a kind of bit of anomaly which has somehow never got swallowed up by development. And it's actually kind of goes more interesting than that, because it's at the bottom of what is called Spring Road, and there is a house at the top called Spring Bank, and there's obviously was a spring that came out of there. It's at the bottom of quite a steep hillside going up to Headingley Hill up the top of Spring Road, and I'm inclined to think that it will have had an ancient significance, because it's just down the hill from the ancient meeting place at the Shire Oak, the Skyrack, original oak, old market square in Headingley, on the top of the hill. And it's very interesting because besides the fact that it's obviously part of the a significant part of the ancient culture of this part of the world, Headingley, which is an ancient settlement, I've met whenever on a number of occasions when I've mentioned this place to people, they say, "Oh, isn't that the place where all the ley lines meet?" And, well, I don't know whether it is or not, But I wouldn't be in the least bit surprised, because it seems to have a kind of magical power to it, that has protected it and kept it there. Interestingly, protected in this triangle, which is a kind of more a magical shape than a square, which most plots are square. People buy and sell square plots of land. Triangular pieces, I suppose, are a little bit more idiosyncratic. And so that's one thing that has helped it. But I'm inclined to think that there's something a bit more to it than that, and that somehow some presence has been there through all this time. I'm a believer in what they call the genius loci, the spirit of a place, and that is a place which has definitely kept it. It is literally a wild woodland. I think there were one or two trees that are kind of there, very old, and a lot of it is just kind of self-seeded, and it is literally a piece of wild woodland in the middle of a very heavily built up area, even though some of the places do have quite nice gardens nearby. And I'm inclined to think that this, it will have had some kind of being where the spring went very nearby, it will almost certainly have had some kind of religious or ritual purpose associated with the Shire meeting place on the top of the hill. And there is also up there, there is also a church called St. Michael's Church, which is obviously built on the old pagan sacred site, as was commonplace in the Dark Ages and the Middle Ages. And so I feel that I've got involved with something which is kind of part of the magical history and past of Leeds, and most especially of Headingley. And it's kind of a little bit like The Mists of Avalon by Marion Zimmer Bradley. But the thing is, I do believe that these are dimensions of reality that can have a stronger or weaker presence in our lives. And I think that we're at a time when the connection with the world of you might call them nature spirits, or you might just call it awareness of nature presence, the living presence within nature. We're living in a time when that has become very diminished, and people have too few people have any sense of connection with the divine spirit in nature. Life, the living biosphere that we are part of, the breathing skin of Mother Gaia, I don't think it's too much of a stretch of the imagination or too speculative to say that there is good evidence to believe that our ancient forebears had a much closer and much more vivid experience of the presence of nature. We've become very alienated from it in cities. Some people have very little contact with plant life, let alone animal life, other than humans. And the human auric field is largely disconnected from contact with and resonance with the living essence of nature that we are part of, that we participate in. I'm thinking of how the painters at places like Lascaux in the south of France, that perhaps 25,000 or more years ago, these people were painting bumps in the rock because it suggested a stag and things like that. These people, 25,000 years ago, the master cave painters, the geniuses of their culture at the time, anything the equivalent of Picasso or Leonardo or Turner or any of the great artists from any culture, and it's quite clear that these artists had a sense of the numinous, a sense of the living nature of the rock, the planet, the living universe that we participate in, at a level of consciousness and myth. And our world has become diminished in its imagination by through the perversion of scientific knowledge and the scientific viewpoint. Obviously, science is very, very it's got us a long way, and it's also got us into some trouble in places. Science is no technology is no replacement for that living connection with the field of nature. Just think about how you feel when you're standing in a place which is all green, even if it's only a large open grassed lawn or field. There is a presence of energization of the body which is simply not present, however well and healthy you might feel, if you are indoors and separated from the earth by, you know, feet of concrete and damp course and all that kind of stuff. I think what one of the significances of this 2012 thing that we've just got through is the idea is that it's kind of like a pendulum going through a swing, and it's reached the down point and is now coming out the other side. And because it's such a long pendulum and it's such a long slow swing, a bit like the spring doesn't come until the sun has been climbing back from its lowest point for 3 months. The spring doesn't start immediately after the 21st of December because the sun started to magnify again, and the seasons are all 3 months behind the solar equivalent of what they're about. And this is because it takes time for energy to embed itself in a system and for it to come through, and so we can't expect to see instant changes, but we should have an understanding, I think, that the reconnection with these energies will increase from now, even though it may be slow at first. Because I'm thinking about how consciousness has been so diminished, to the point where communication has become so cliched and stylized and limited. I'm thinking of things like the text message, all sorts of styles of TV and games and things. When our ancestors used to roam the wild, alert to all sorts of uncertainties and possibilities, every moment was an adventure and a sensory experience of unparalleled breadth, compared to the little, narrowly defined realities that we all too often find ourselves in the technological society. And then there is all the implications for social control that those limited social structures give themselves to. So I think that the spontaneous community impulse from people who are far more involved with it than I am, to clean up the place and make it tidier and restore the walls and railings and get it all getting painted, and a bit of work has already been done where there was some damage from a crashed car, and it's a wonderful feeling that the community is kind of honouring the presence of what this you know, would be the spring, the spirit of the spring, the nature spirit that was probably recognised by the ancient Anglo-Saxons and Celts, who met around the hilltop, and then they would go down into the valley and there would be the sacred spring. And it's wonderful to think that there's still some essential essence of this tradition there, and it's and I feel that regenerating our culture, what better starting point could you have in the beginning of a great new long cycle of equinoctial time, that the sacred woodlands and the sacred springs and the sacred nature spirits are being honoured and having their little patch kind of looked after and protected. I think that is a wonderful thing for the imagination to work with and to take us forward. And I think that a lot of stuff like this is the starting point for recreating our communities, because the mainstream has certainly gone a long way from the path that it should be on. So we have to find it again for ourselves, and we have to find it in community and in relationship to our sacred natural environment. There we are, folks. Okay, that's my thoughts for this evening. And if you get a chance, just take a walk past Sparrow Park, at the bottom of Spring Road, off Headingley by Cardigan Road. It's a lovely little place. Okay, so thank you for listening, and in luck, Cash. See you tomorrow. Good night.